darling, the way you say yes. Stay as sweet as you are, discreet as you are. You're divine, dear. As you are, and as you are, tell me that you're mine, dear. Young and gay, or old and gray, near to me or above.
We stood and talked like this before. We looked at each other in the same way then, but I can't remember where or when. The clothes you're wearing are the clothes you wore. The smile you are smiling, you were smiling then, but I can't remember where or when. Some things that happen for the first time seem to be happening again. So it seems that we have met.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm calling the regular monthly meeting of the Parks and Recreation Commission to order for Wednesday, July 22nd, 2015. And if you'd all rise for the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. Ms. McGill, would you call roll, please?
Chair Wiscombe?
Here.
Longstreet?
Here.
Rincon?
Here.
French?
Here.
Cevezos, Clark, Heaton, and Intern Rodriguez are not present.
Thank you very much. Ms. Rapp, are there any changes to the agenda?
No, Chair, no changes.
Okay, fine. And written communications, nothing there. Okay, public comment. Any member of the public may address the commission for up to 2 minutes on any subject within the jurisdiction of the commission that is not scheduled for public discussion before the commission. And we have one speaker slip. Mr. Locke, welcome.
I got 2 minutes, or are you going to work that?
Oh, wait a minute. There you go.
Okay.
My name is
Kenneth Locke. I went before the city council pushing my tennissance, the renaissance of tennis, or the tennissance method. And I mentioned to them that I represent the first teacher now of tennis that we can understand as being intelligent and then also coordinated. And now I can actually make it possible for the children, or actually everybody, all the tennis players, to renew their relationship, next generation, in relation to, again, holistic health, developing both arms. It's kind of everything that tennis that we've ever known, Tennaissance method, isn't. And everything that Tennaissance method is, tennis isn't. Tennaissance is not competitive. It's just right across the board, everything, again. But the idea that we're going before the school board, and you know, this is new information, a new news, new opportunity for people, again, to become intelligent and understand what it means to be intelligent, understand the basis of being sound mind, sound body. And it turns out that historically tennis has not been generating people to the point of their full evolution, fully evolved, full circle, and it actually has caused them to be kind of degenerative in relation to their mental health and also physical health, and that needs to be corrected. And if it isn't corrected, then what it is we just continue on this degenerative type of mode. And I hope that maybe this community will take a grab onto this opportunity and do something with it. But I'll be going before the school board and see if I can find some people that have an interest in pushing this forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Locke. Appreciate it. And that closes public comment. And we do not have a youth council report today. So I'm going to move on to commissioner committee assignment reports. We'll just go down the row. Ms. French.
Thank you. I participated in the Arts and Crafts Show monthly meeting last week on Tuesday, and they're making some good progress. They've got the new advertising that's going out there. They're still struggling with the road construction, but they feel like they're getting good communications along the way and appreciate the support they're getting.
Thank you. Ms. Longstreet?
I attended the NAC meeting this last month and the Park Foundation meeting. At the Park Foundation, we are getting ready for the 90-plus birthday party in October. We're looking for sponsors. We serve around 100 residents of our community that are 90 years or older, and it's a wonderful event, so we encourage people to support it.
Great. Thank you very much. Mr. Rincon?
I, too, went to the Neighborhood Advisory Council meeting, and we have a new chair that has been elected. Anyways, there's some organizational issues that will be addressed here short with.
Don't have that deer in the headlights look.
Yeah, it'll be good. I'm looking forward to taking it on for the year.
Great. You'll be great. Okay, I attended the Street Tree Advisory Committee meeting on July 2nd. We had Mr. Downey reported on enforcement. We had two new enforcement cases and a total of four enforcement cases open. And then the committee visited the sites of the trees that are on your agenda today. On the 8th of July, I attended the regular Golf Advisory Committee meeting, and I'll just share a couple statistics from the reports that Mr. Sewell puts together from that, which are very thorough. Rounds in June 2015 were up 6% from June of 14. Paid rounds were down 2% from the budgeted amount for June 2015. And for FY 2015, paid rounds were down 5.2% from the budgeted amount. And revenue in FY 2015 was down about $20,000 from FY 2014. I also attended the Park Foundation meeting, and as Ms. Longstreet says, we're really looking for sponsors for the 90th plus party. It's one of the best events of the year. It's a real kick. So if you know anyone who might participate and sponsor that, we would love to hear from you. Thank you very much. Yes, Ms. French.
I'm sorry, I neglected to mention that if you haven't recently been to the Arts and Crafts Show downtown on Sundays, every Sunday, I highly encourage you to do so. They have wonderful new vendors and terrific products for summer, so I do encourage you to come on down on Sundays. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. And they just celebrated 50 years. Yes. The oldest, I think the oldest in the country, right? Yeah. Okay. We are moving on to commission and staff communications. Ms. Rapp?
Chair and commissioners, I am very pleased to introduce Summers Case, who is our marketing and communications coordinator for the department. And Summers is going to present you with our new parks map. And I believe you all got copies. So with that, I would like to introduce to you Summers Case.
Hello, Chair and Commission. I'm Summers Case, Marketing Coordinator. I handle marketing and communications for the Parks and Recreation Department. I'm here to tell you about the new Parks Map. It's a free printed resource, and it's one of our most requested publications consistently. The map started life in 2008. You may remember it as the Park and Facility Guide. The 2008 original was a great resource, but it was in need of updating, and supplies were running low, so staff decided to reprint and update. Staff completed the map design in-house this time, and our priorities were to make the new map more user-friendly, more functional, so with more and more useful information, and more visually appealing. As you look at the new map, you'll see that it differs from the old map in a number of ways. The new map has a simpler, more modern design style. It fits with our department brand identity. It uses more visible, easily identifiable legend icons in bright colors. And it uses easier to read typography. We eliminated the complicated cross-reference system from the old map and pulled the place names onto the map itself. For example, playgrounds are indicated by a magenta smiley face icon. And then the descriptions of each individual park on the back tell you which age groups each playground is best for. So that's one example. We also provided more information on picnic sites, hiking trails, rules for dog owners, and we made notes of which locations are popular for parties and weddings traditionally. We added more locations around Santa Barbara to the map, including libraries, the harbor, cultural points of interest. And we also added notes on locations of city-sponsored events, such as the 4th of July fireworks, concerts in the park, and the Santa Barbara Arts and Crafts Show. The new map has been available for about a week, and we've gotten very positive feedback. Other city departments have asked us for copies to give out at their locations, and local businesses are starting to display it as well, which is great. We've promoted the new map through the City News and Brief weekly email, and through city and department social media outlets, as well as the Parks and Recreation news page at santabarbaraca.gov/parksandrec. Overall, the Parks and Recreation map is a project I'm particularly proud of. I'm glad we were able to add to and improve on an already valuable community resource for locals and tourists. And the map is available at Parks and Recreation department locations, as well as at City Hall, the Central Library, and will soon be at the Santa Barbara Airport. And a PDF version is also available online at santabarbaraca.gov/parksandrec. Thank you.
Great.
I was just going to add, I actually have always encouraged people to put one of the park maps in the glove compartment of their car, because then you have it when you're wanting to go take a walk someplace new or go investigate some park that you've heard of but you haven't been to. And so then it's always convenient for you. So the basket of your bike or in your glove box of your car. So it's a great tool. Jill?
Great. And commissioners, if I could just add, Summers is quite humble about this work product. And do want to take the time to acknowledge that she essentially built it from the ground up, but also acknowledge that she reached out to many different department staff and got a lot of input and made it the best map that it could be, and we're very proud of the product as well.
Thank you for saying that, Ms. Zachary. Yes, I noticed the...
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's really great. Does anyone have any questions or comments? Yeah.
I wanted to applaud you for getting it hooked in right away to the city-based email system. That's the first time I saw it. Immediately opened it up. It was great. It was, it's early enough in the summer, too. So I noticed it right away. Thanks.
And the posting to Facebook, which... I had just one question. Did you have something, Mr. Rincon?
Yes. Simple comment. I love the map, by the way.
Thank you.
So the online version is going to be quite similar, I would take?
It is exactly the same in the PDF version. We do have an interactive parks map that's more Google Maps based, and it's easy to zoom in on your phone. And we're working on sort of making that resource visually similar to this new map as well, so that the branding will carry over.
Well, thank you, Ms. Case.
Good. And I had just one question, Ms. Case. What was it? Oh, is it available at Visit Santa Barbara and the tourist office on Garden?
Or Wiscombe. It will be.
Okay.
We'll be delivering it this week. So,
great.
Yes.
Good. Thank you very much. That's a wonderful job. It's really easy to read and going to be easy to find your way around to some of these parks. I like Ms. Rapp's suggestion about keeping it in your glove box. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Okay. Let me just fold this. Did you have anything else to communicate, Ms. Rapp?
Chair Wiscombe, the only thing that I did want to do is remind the commission that on Tuesday, the 28th, the City Council will be providing direction to staff on the golf course. Staff report is complete, I will send you the link when the agenda comes out so that you have it. It will be on, I believe the agenda hasn't come out yet, but I believe it will just be an afternoon session. So that's where we are.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay. I had just one thing that the commission would like to share. And I'd like to ask Ms. Rapp to come up to that microphone, which I don't even know if you've ever been there, Nancy.
Probably when I introduced myself to the commission when I started with the city.
Some of us can't remember that far back.
Okay, as we all know, Nancy is retiring, and we're going to miss her. And the commission wanted to give you something from the commission, so we put together this little plaque for you. And you probably know who might have designed it, but... But we put the words on it. We put the words. And I did want to read the words just because it's to Nancy Rapp with appreciation and recognition of Nancy, an inspirational and dedicated leader committed to collaboration, hard work, and excellence with spirited enthusiasm for community recreation and public parks and open spaces. So on behalf of the commission, Nancy, we'd like you to have that. And we also have a little card for you in here and a little something to get you started on your first project in the garden.
Are you donating your landscape sign services?
No, I don't do residential, so. I did park work, not residential work, so. No, I think you'll find what's in there far more valuable than my services would be.
So you would do the design and everybody else would show up with their shovel.
Oh, now that's a novel.
We love you, bud.
Thank you. I wasn't prepared to say anything. So let me just say
coming to this decision was very bittersweet, and ever since I announced, it's been wonderful to have people stop me and talk about their recognition or appreciation of what I've been able to bring to the agency. And similarly, then I've felt great pride and fulfillment and sadness. And I'm very proud of this department. I have particularly enjoyed working with all of the commissioners over the years. I've been amazed as people have rotated on and rotated off. We have always been so lucky that the Parks and Recreation Commission has worked together as a team and always for the good of the community and the Parks and Recreation Department. So it's been a great experience. It's been a great ride. And thank you very much. Very appreciated. Thank you.
We will all miss you.
Yes, it's yes. But we wish you the best in your retirement. I know you're not retiring per se, but you're just not coming to work anymore.
And after August 7th, if we see you again, we'll see you. You're getting practice for being at that place instead of that place. So, okay, great. Okay, we're going to move on to the consent calendar agenda item number one, summary of council actions. Did you have anything you wanted to report on there, Nancy, Ms. Rapp in particular?
Chair and commissioners, only if you had any questions. So I think most things that are on here are things that you're aware of already. So if you had questions, I'd be happy to.
Anyone have any questions? Okay. Okay, so now we're going to move on to approval of the minutes, and we have two sets of minutes, one from the special joint meeting with the Gulf Advisory Committee on June 15th, 2015, and then the regular commission meeting of June 24th, 2015. Does anyone have any corrections, or would anyone like them taken separately for any reason?
I move approval of the meeting minutes for June 15th and for June 24th.
That will be seconded.
Okay. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. You don't have to. You can vote. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Fine. You just can't make a motion, but you can vote. Yeah. Okay. Okay, fine. So now we're going to move on to item number three, which is Street Tree Advisory Committee items and any action of the Parks and Rec Commission made pursuant to the Municipal Code Chapter 15.24, Preservation of Trees, may be appealed to City Council within 10 days. And welcome, Mr. Downey. We'll start with item 3A1, 136 San Rafael Avenue, and we do have a couple speakers for this. So Mr. Downey will give his report, then we'll open it up to the commission for questions only, and then we'll hear from the speakers, and then back to the commission for discussion. So, Mr. Downey?
Chair Wiscombe and Commissioners, the tree at 136 San Rafael Avenue is a Eucalyptus polyanthemus, silver dollar gum eucalyptus. The applicant, when they installed their driveway, noted that there was a significant amount of roots, some of which were entering into the sewer lateral. That problem has been corrected. They're concerned that the tree will cause future damage to other underground utility lines and the sidewalk, the curb, and their personal property as well. The committee reviewed the application materials, went out to the site, and determined that all of those concerns are things that can be maintained, and the community would be at a loss for canopy in this area if this tree were removed. Their recommendation is to deny the removal.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Downey. Does any of my fellow commissioners have any questions on this item before we... open it up to public. Okay, so we're opening it up for public comment. It'll be 2 minutes, and our first speaker is Nick Svensson, and followed by Jessica Kinahan.
Do I start? Or
yeah.
So I am one of the owners. My wife and I are here of 136. I think there's we weren't here to submit personally. We were actually out of the country visiting family in Sweden. My wife's a teacher, so took some time off. To clarify, we remodeled the home, and when we did, we were required to do a sewer line video, and in so doing, we had to replace the entire sewer line because of the tree roots. And also at the same time, the gas company came to the property. We had to replace the entire gas line because of the tree roots, and we had to go above ground with the gas meter as well. And at that time, we had the water meter, the main water meter, and lo and behold, we had to replace the water, the entire water meter and the water line. We were on the only hook for the plumbing too, but it was pretty expensive. And so both the gas company and the plumber decided that it will happen again. This tree is getting too big for its location. I mean, I love the tree. I grew up in this house. I was actually there when they planted that tree in the late 70s, because that was our outfield when we used to play baseball from the house across the street. So my goal isn't to remove canopy from the street. It's actually the opposite. The tree below and above are actually touching. I think the tree has just gotten too big for its location. The limbs are coming down regularly. We have had now emergency crews there on the last two storms, and big trees. I have photos on my car. I have a dent on my hood still that I saved just for good luck. I can't park under it. The maintenance, I don't mind. It's just too big. So I would be more than happy to replace it with the exact same tree, something that is better suited size-wise, if need be, preferably a little bit over more so we have a better view coming in and out of our driveway. So my 2 minutes is up. So, but I can go on for a little while. I do have some paperwork here I'd like to show you as well that I'll hand to him. If you, yes, thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
It's just photos. And then there was a tree taken down, the exact same tree, for the exact same reason a year and a half ago, exact same size. So I thought that would actually play into it a little bit as well. That one is what you want. Oh. That's the other tree that went down. Exact same tree came down.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Next speaker is Jessica Kinahan.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, Commissioners. My name is Jessica Kinahan Foley. I am here on behalf of Nick and Tara Svensson. If I could take a moment just to congratulate Nancy. I met you back in 2000 when I was on the Parks and Rec Commission as well, and thank you for all your service. So I had to toss that in. I think what you'll see, and in your notes that have been presented with staff's recommendation, was that we didn't have an opportunity to supply enough evidence, and that's on me. I was at the meeting, and unfortunately, well, fortunately for them, they were having a wonderful family vacation. So I think when you have the evidence in front of you, you'll be able to see the public works permit documenting the changes they had to make to their sewer line and water line. You'll also see the tree damage to their car, and you'll also see the evidence related to the other same tree that was removed about a year and a half ago. So with that, happy to answer any questions or bring Nick or Tara back up if you have any further questions for them as well.
Does anyone have any questions? Okay. Can you give us, thank you very much for that. Okay, that closes public comment. Can you just give us a minute to let the commissioners just look over the additional information that was provided? Because it was not provided to the...
Madam Chair, would it be appropriate to refer this back to STAC with the new evidence?
I think that's an excellent suggestion.
Then I would make that motion.
Okay.
I would second that motion also.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second to send it back to Street Tree Advisory Committee. And I assume, Mr. Downey, it could get on the agenda for the August meeting. Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, great. That passes unanimously.
Commissioners, if I could ask, when you finished going through the packet, if you could hand those to Ms. McGill, and then we can make them available to Mr. Downey.
Great. Okay. Thank you.
Just as a comment, you know, I don't want to rush to take down a tree, you know, and I'd rather have the experts on stack review it again.
I think that was an excellent approach to this situation because the information was not available to stack at that time. There was no, although there was reference to the fact that there had been damage, there was nothing that was going to prove that. So, okay, great. We're going to move on to item 3B1, which is 224 West Islay Street. Mr. Downey.
Chair Wiskam and Commissioners, 224 West Islay Street has a medium-sized bunya pine directly adjacent to the home. I say medium-sized because this tree can get much larger than this. The concerns are for future damage to the foundation of the home and some existing minor damage to the driveway and walkway that lead up to that front unit. The committee reviewed the item and determined that there really isn't much evidence that the tree is causing any current damage other than some hardscapes that can be repaired, the driveway and the walkway up to the home. So since there's a lack of evidence to support that there's any damage occurring, the committee determined that the loss of this tree would be a significant impact to the neighborhood, and the recommendation is to deny the removal.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Downey. It's back to the commission for any questions or discussion. Yes, Ms. French.
Thank you. Mr. Downey, can you? I'm not super familiar with this particular species of tree. Can you describe, is it shallow roots, deep roots, broad expansive roots, narrow tap roots? You know, can you sort of, what are we looking at as far as growth patterns?
Chair Wiskam and Commissioner French, there's a common fallacy about how tree roots normally grow. People believe that the roots grow down similar to what the top grows. That's not the case. Tree roots grow where they can get air and moisture, and typically that's in the top 3 feet of soil. So the tree essentially sends out roots in all directions around it. Almost all of it is within the top 3 feet of soil. So there are likely roots underneath that foundation.
Ms. Longstreet?
My question when I looked at the tree was that there's a chimney, it appears, that's within several feet of the tree and has greenery around it. Is that a hazard that needs to be addressed?
Chair Wiskam and Commissioner Longstreet, in previous cases, we have consulted with the fire department with this issue. They are less concerned if the tree is at least 10 feet away from the chimney. In this case, the tree is about that distance. We might recommend pruning to get it a little farther away.
Also, it appeared to be just about touching the house on that roof on the single-story part of it.
Chair Wiskam, Commissioner Longstreet, are you referring to the trunk of the tree?
The trunk of the tree. Is it going to increase in diameter, or are we going to be looking at an issue with that in the near future?
It shouldn't substantially increase in diameter at that height. It will get quite a bit bigger at the base. It will get bigger at the roof location, but not for many more years.
Okay.
So there's really no evidence of foundation uplift or anything like that?
Chair Wiskam and Commissioner Ibarra, I did reach out to the applicant to find out if they had any additional documentation, and they said that they are not seeing any evidence at this time.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, I would entertain a motion if someone wants to make one. Yes.
I'd move to concur with the Street Tree Advisory Committee recommendation at 224 West Islay Street.
I would second that motion.
Yes. We're back to discussion. Yes, go right ahead.
If the permit request is denied, the removal is denied, can the owners come back in a year or two if they see evidence and apply again?
Chair Wiscombe and Commissioner French, no decision to deny a removal is a permanent decision. If conditions change later, they can always resubmit an application and get an additional review.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, that carries unanimously. Thank you. We're moving on to agenda item 3C1, which is 1387 Sycamore Canyon Road. Mr. Downey?
Chair Wiscombe and Commissioners, the owners at 1387 Sycamore Canyon Road are interested in placing solar panels on their roof. As you can see in the photo, they have many other trees. They're only requesting the removal of this one tree. The tree does drop a significant amount of debris in their patio area in the front. It is breaking up a planter that it's planted in. They're interested in removing it to stop that damage and decrease the debris while still making the solar panels viable for use. The committee reviewed the application and did a site visit, and they determined that the loss of the tree would not be a significant impact to the area, and that the installation of solar panels would be a reasonable development of that property. Their recommendation is to conditionally approve on the condition that the tree permit is not pulled until the owners receive their permit for the solar panel installation. The committee was not certain at the time of the meeting that a permit would be required. I confirmed that with Building and Safety that there is a permit required.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Downey. Okay. And it's back to the commission for any questions or a motion.
Well, I'll move.
Did you fill out a speaker slip, sir?
I didn't know that I had to.
Oh, okay.
Come on up,
and you can have 2 minutes. You'll have to state your name, and then if you'd be so kind as to fill out a slip in the back so we can include it in the public record. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Jeff McKeska, owner of the property. One other thing besides what Mr. Downing mentioned is you can see here that
Talk into the microphone, please.
The picture that those Edison lines, the one on top of the T, you see where they're kind of light. Every year Edison comes by and they trim all the branches from that side, and they've been doing it for as long as the tree's been growing. So it's not a very good picture of that aspect of the tree, but all the branches on that side are about 4 feet long, and all the branches on the other side hang way out over into the patio and near the roof area. So the tree's starting to lean a little bit, and we're also in a high fire area. So I'm concerned with the fire aspect of it, the leaning aspect of it, and the fact the way that Edison has been trimming it for many years, so there's no branches. I have a better picture on here if that'll help. if you can see. See how this side is all trimmed away and this side is much larger.
Let's see.
And I'd like to have unconditional approval whether the solar panels go in or not, that the tree can be removed.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for your comments. Okay, I'm closing public comment. And please fill out a slip for our records. Thank you. Okay, and now it is to the commission.
Well, yes. Now I would ask a question of Mr. Downey about the Edison pruning. Always a question, I think, for us. Did you see evidence of that those issues?
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioner Longstreet, Edison has been pruning this tree to keep their lines clear. They will continue to do so. Whether or not that tree is there, they will prune other trees as well. That in itself is a non-issue. They will continue to prune that tree as long as it's safe to do so.
Do you have any comments or any guidance on the conditional approval versus non-conditional approval?
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioner Longstreet, it's my belief that the committee would not likely have approved the removal without the reasonable development of the property. The debris in the patio can be cleaned up. The planter can be rebuilt. The Edison wires are being dealt with. The lien has, there's no structural problems with the tree that would create a safety hazard because of the lien. It's my opinion that their recommendation without the solar panel condition would be to deny.
What about distance to the house in the fire area?
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioner Longstreet, there is an exemption in the municipal code if the fire department orders the removal of the tree for fire safety. The owner is certainly welcome to pursue that venue if they choose to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments or questions? Yes, Ms. Friend? Sure, go right ahead.
I move to concur with the committee's recommendation to give a conditional approval for removal.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so that carries unanimously. Thank you. Okay, we're moving on to item 3D1, the zero block of West Los Olivos Street. And we do have one speaker for this particular item. So again, Mr. Downey will give a report. We'll open it up to the commission for any questions and then public comment and then back to the commission for discussion and a motion. So, Mr. Downey.
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioners, the 0-100 block of West Los Olivos Street is currently designated strawberry tree. The applicants are desiring to improve their property to increase the visibility of things in the area. They've had some tagging occur on their walls, so they're trying to spruce up the place so that it's more attractive and maybe discourage some of that activity. They like the burst of color on the trees that they're proposing and think that that would be a bonus to the neighborhood. They circulated a petition, which is in your packet, and several of the property owners that have the strawberry tree don't care for that tree because of the fruit drop. The Couch has worked with me to come up with a solid plan to move forward to you. To designate other trees. They expressed that concern about the fruit and wanted to designate other trees, so they worked with me on that item. They did quite a bit of research. as is in your packet. They've given you many pictures of the trees that they're proposing. Those trees are the Parkinsonia floridea, the Palo Verde tree, and Prosopis chilensis, the Chilean mesquite. Both trees have yellow flowers and have a lighter textured leaf. The Chilean mesquite is a little more dense and provides a little more shade than the Palo Verde. The committee reviewed the application materials. They went out on site. At the suggestion of Mr. Couch, we actually did a site visit to a location where there are street trees of the Chilean mesquite. The committee determined that that tree does provide more shade than the Palo Verde. They were reluctant to add three species of tree. The request is to add these two species. So the committee determined that the Chilean mesquite, since it provides more shade, would be suitable for that block to add to the designation. So the committee's recommendation is to add Prosopis chilensis, Chilean mesquite to the designated street tree for the 0-100 block of West Los Olivos.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Downey. Does anyone have any questions?
No.
Okay. Then I'll open it up for public comment, and we have Mr. Eric Couch here. Welcome.
Thank you.
And thank you for all your hard work putting together the materials. So.
Thank you, Chair Wiskum. Thank you, Commission. Thank you, Mr. Downey. So this was a wonderful experience reaching out to all our neighbors on the street. And I don't know if the map is in the package, if that might be brought up. The whole street is, it has four remaining pittosporum that are dying, and so they're due to come down soon. And there are many parkways that have no trees at all. So it's the perfect time for us to establish something that the whole street really wants. This exercise prompted us to ask people genuinely, do you like the strawberry tree? And I was very surprised at the emphatic response. Most of us are dog owners, and these strawberry trees put down so much fruit that for the couple months when they're fruiting, it's a mess. And the neighbors emphatically said, we don't care what it takes. Please get rid of the strawberry tree designation. So perfectly appreciate that the Palo Verde loses its leaves and doesn't provide quite as much canopy as the Chilean mesquite. However, the contrast against the Spanish houses on the street, I think, is fabulous. And I would like to also point out that in this time of water scarcity, the Palo Verde is known to need water once a month, whereas the strawberry trees are known to need water much more often. So these trees are more desert origin, and we'd love to see the designation of these two trees and the strawberry taken off the list just because no one on the block wants it. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Couch. Appreciate it. Okay, I'm going to close public comment. And it's back to the commission. Does anyone have any questions or discussion? Yes, Ms. French?
Mr. Downey, what is it possible to take a tree off the master plan altogether, even though there are some of those trees on the block at this time?
Chair Wiskum and Commissioner French, as part of this process, it's the commission's discretion to designate species for given blocks. That could mean removal of a species, or it could mean addition of species, or complete changes to species altogether. So that's certainly within your purview.
Okay. I'm going to just make a comment here, because this was a... The Street Tree Advisory Committee spent a lot of time on this, and there were a couple things that came up during their site visit and site visit to see the Chilean mesquite. And one of the things that they asked was, would the Arbutus marina be okay, because that doesn't fruit as much. That was my understanding from the discussion, right? Would that be acceptable if the strawberry tree was left on the designated list?
Chair Wiskin and Commissioners, the current designation is Arbutus unido, which is strawberry tree. The Marina strawberry tree is also Arbutus unido, but it is a subvariety Marina. So under the current designation, it's a subvariety of what is designated and could be planted in place of the strawberry tree without a change to the designation. The experience with that tree is that it there are two reasons it produces less fruit drop. One of those is that being a subvariety just simply isn't as successful at producing fruit. And the second reason is the birds seem to like that fruit more than they do the regular strawberry tree, so they're eating more of the fruit. So for those two reasons, it has much less fruit drop. Certainly, it would not be a violation of the designation to plant the Marina variety of the strawberry tree.
Great. Okay. Because that, and then there was something else that. Oh, and the other thing that I know the committee struggled with, they were thinking, you know, maybe have all three, and I know three on one street is just on this particular block was not acceptable. Is that correct, Mr. Downey? That was. Staff doesn't want to have three different trees on, and I think pretty much the Street Tree Advisory Committee thought it might be a little mottled looking.
Chair Wiskin, Commissioners, currently existing on the street are I believe five different varieties of trees, maybe more. No, I'm maybe six or seven, and it's a short city block. None of those trees will be removed until either they become a safety issue, they die, or somebody is successful in an application to remove them. So by adding three designated species, we would be increasing the number of diverse species in this one little block by two additional trees, it becomes a bit of a maintenance issue for the different styles trees for staff to deal with. So the committee is sensitive to that, and they did not want to designate two additional trees and retain the strawberry tree. So therefore, their recommendation was to add the Chilean mesquite.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Ms. Longstreet.
I don't understand why we have to retain the strawberry tree designation. What was the thinking behind, if there's only four of those on the block, there's four dying pittosporums too by this map, why do we have to keep it?
Chair Wiskin, Commissioner Longstreet, the committee commented on that. They like the dense shade that it provides, and neither of these trees quite get there to produce the dense shade. They like the variety of the textures of trees. The one that is currently designated has a broader, darker green leaf, and the proposed trees both have smaller, more fine textured leaves. They are also deciduous, and the strawberry tree is not, so it provides some variety there as well. So those were the comments of the committee why they were recommending to retain the strawberry tree.
Yeah, I think I back that up 100%. You did a very good job explaining that, because the things that the deciduous versus evergreen was one, the committee went to a different site to look at the Chilean mesquite, and they weren't as familiar with that tree as they were with the Palo Verde. And Mr. Couch was nice enough to tell them exactly where to go, and they looked at it, and they liked the fact that it did provide more shade than the Palo Verde does. And they also liked the contrast between the darker green, as Mr. Downey explained, on the strawberry tree and the lighter green of the Chilean mesquite. So there's a very nice specimen of the Chilean mesquite just down a few blocks. So, yes, Ms. French.
And by having the strawberry tree and the Chilean mesquite on the master plan, as the street trees get replaced by any of the means that you mentioned, there would be a choice then of which one would get planted, and it could be the Chilean mesquite.
Chair Withgood, Commissioner French, that's correct.
Okay, any other questions? Does anyone have a motion?
Oh. I guess I'm just having a hard time because we have so much community involvement in this, and I just love it when people really take an interest in their trees. Those four strawberry trees are not going to come out. We're not going to take a healthy tree out to replace it, so we've got four we'll keep. I have a hard time with this one.
Well, I'm going to make a motion because I was there, and I really think that this was a very well thought out decision to designate these two species, and they did spend a lot of time on it, and there was a lot of discussion. So I will make the motion to concur with the Street Tree Advisory Committee and retain the Arbutus unido and add the Prosopis chilensis. Do I hear a second? Okay, the motion failed, so go at it.
Well, I also have a hard time going against the decision made by STAC, so I will second your motion.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? I think on this block, you know, they both provide interest, they both provide contrast, and they both provide shade. And those are things that we're obviously looking for, not only beauty, but environmental qualities that improve our streets. So that's
And I would just say we do have to take the advice of the experts that guide us on this. And I appreciate all the work you've done on this.
Yes, Ms. French.
Mr. Downing, do community members, if a tree needs to be replaced on that block, do community members have an opportunity to make a choice or a recommendation which of the two trees that are in the master plan get planted in that stead?
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioner French, trees get planted in a neighborhood for two reasons. Either staff identifies it as an area that needs to be planted, and we're doing a project in there and we want to maximize our effort, or we get a request from the citizens. In situations where we have multiple trees designated and all of the conditions are the same on the block, we do approach the residents and say, we'd like to plant a tree. We've got some choices here. We'd like your input. When the situation, not in the case of Los Olivos, but in other situations, there's different designations because the parkway size changes or other reasons that it changes. So sometimes a different tree is selected for those smaller spaces or larger spaces, as the case may be. In those situations, we tend to go with the largest tree that would fit into that size of parkway. So we wouldn't typically plant a small tree in a really large parkway if we have room for the large tree. So we would encourage people to accept the larger tree in that situation.
Sorry, my mic wasn't on. Any other discussion? Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Abstain.
You abstain?
Yeah.
Okay, so it carries 3-0-1. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Downey. We're moving on to agenda item number 4, forestry tree maintenance and watering data collection and analysis project. Woo, that's a mouthful.
Sure is.
Welcome, Ms. Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the Commission, thank you for having me. Mandy Burgess, Administrative Analyst with the Parks and Recreation Department. I have with me Sam Fragoso, project intern who's been helping us since end of January, beginning of February on this project, as well as some other forestry-related objectives. We're here today to present the Forestry Tree Maintenance and Watering Data Collection Analysis Project. This is a project that we began last July. We've actually been reporting on the results internally each quarter, and we're wrapping up our year-end report. But this was a project that was developed out of the desire and the need to understand what is achievable in tree maintenance and watering given our current resources. And really that was taking a more in-depth look at all the factors that influence our staff time when they're working on trees or watering trees. And then with this confidence in our capacity, we can better illustrate where future additional resources might be placed. So the drought conditions and the need to manage water in a different way really helped catalyze this, were a catalyst for this project moving forward. The department was facing a number of issues with trees and the impending drought. We had young trees that were not establishing as quickly and needing water longer. We have mature trees needing water, certain species of trees, pines and eucalyptus. And then we have historic resources that we're looking to protect. And all of this requires more staff time and resources. So we were really trying to get a handle on what our capacity was. And again, taking that leap and understanding of what additional resources might help us achieve greater objectives. And of course, all of this does help support the objectives outlined in the Urban Forest Management Plan. So to begin the project, we had to expand some data sheets that field staff already were using to collect the data. So if you're looking up in the screen, the white indicates data that was already being collected by our staff, and then we had to expand that data collection. So for tree maintenance, staff are already collecting location, maintenance category in terms of if it was a removal, a trimming, emergency. The tree species, and then we asked them to collect time, that should be in green. The number of staff on site, tree diameter, site complexity, this is a scoring system that we developed, and I'll talk about that in the next slide. And then any additional information that helps us understand the issues at the site. For tree watering, staff are already collecting location and tree species, and again, we ask them to expand that to time, number of staff, water usage. We installed meters on the water truck and trailer to help us acquire that data. The tree's health, just keeping tabs on the tree health. The tree category is whether it was a young tree, a historic tree, park tree, et cetera. And then again, any other comments that need to be made. And this was really a team effort, field staff collecting data in the field, real time, several office staff looking, you know, doing the data entry, the analysis, and the reporting. So I mentioned that we developed a site complexity scoring system, and this is a system that we developed to help us communicate and understand the site's accessibility and its difficulty. So 0 through 3, 0 being that there's no inhibiting factors. Generally, staff can roll up to this tree, work fairly easily, and get out. If we're looking at a 1, this is kind of what we call our normal factors. Maybe there's cars or people involved. Number 2, we're compounding the situation. Maybe we've got overhead utility lines, other structures, signs. And then 3, this is really kind of your busiest location, a busy street corner. There's lots of people, your state streets, your this, that. And so really this is affecting staff's ability to do work along with other things, the size of the tree, you know, the actual work they're doing. But this was, again, just a system we wanted to develop to support the data collection. So these two pictures just help illustrate the site complexity. If you look on the left, there's a site with numerous complexities. You can see the overhead lines. There's cars, there's people in the background and houses, and this is actually near a busy street corner. And then on the right hand, you see a site with no complexities. So again, just what are the other external factors affecting our time? And another example that this commission is well aware of, we had four historic stone pines removed not that long ago. That was a very challenging site, the size of the trees, the challenging site, and in addition to the fact that we were removing those all led to each tree averaging 60 hours a tree. So this is helping us to quantify this data and this information. So Sam and I are going to tag team this, and he'll present the results, and I'll come back and wrap it up, but I'll give it to Sam.
Okay, so the above table...
Sam, would you introduce yourself, please, to those of us that don't know you, and welcome.
Hi, I'm Sam Fragoso. I'm a project intern here. And I've been working here since late January, early February. Thanks. So the above table shows a summary of fiscal year 15 results for tree maintenance. The left category lists, the left column lists the work categories such as trimming, removal, stump removal, removal of tree and stump, emergencies, plantings, and inspections or picking up limbs. Associated with each of these categories is the count of trees by work category, or just the number of trees maintained by that, the percentage of total workload, the staff time, the percentage of total staff time, and the average time spent per tree. As illustrated, trimming consumes the vast majority of maintenance. It accounts for 87% of the total workload, 74% of the total time, and an hour to trim any given tree. With that being said, removal of tree and stumps and emergencies are less than 2%, but they require on average 20 hours and 5 hours respectively to maintain any given occurrence. And this is important because these events are often unplanned and very time intensive. So knowing the standard times allows us the ability to plan for one of these occurrences, as it will disrupt the daily trim cycle and daily maintenance.
Chair Wescombe and Commissioners, I'm sorry to interrupt, but the previous slide here is the one figure that stands out for me is that 20 hours for tree and stump removal. That includes those four Italian stone pines that were over the roadway, right where Milpas meets Anapamu. So those four trees dramatically skewed that number.
Sorry, one addition to this, planting, we've been halting our planting. So as Mr. Downey said, that we have some areas where we need more information to really gain confidence in these, and planting, removing tree and stump is one of those.
So this graph basically shows an increase in time required on site as complexity increases. It shows that complexity has the ability to double or even triple the amount of time required to maintain a certain tree. While it's also important to note that while not shown the size of a tree, the species of a tree, as well as the specific work required, also factors into the amount of time required to maintain a tree. So this table is a summary of fiscal year 15 watering results. The left-hand column displays young trees with and without gator bags, historic trees, or namely the Italian stone pines and Anapamu, with and without ericades, mature trees, median trees, park trees, and those that were not categorized. And associated with each category are the total number of waterings, or the number of times this tree got watered, the sum of usage in gallons, the average usage per tree, as well as the average time to water a given tree. Again, as shown, the young trees, followed by the historic Italian stone pines, consume the vast majority of waterings. The young trees with gator bags drop down to 13 minutes per tree compared to the young trees without gator bags, and this is a direct reflection of the efficiency and time saved through installing these gator bags. Historic trees have the same effect. Installing the irrigates lowered the average time to maintain the trees down to 16 minutes from 71 minutes. In addition to the savings in time, young trees and historic trees consume the vast majority of water given to any of these trees. And noting that the total amount of water at the bottom accounts for 0.3% of the total water used throughout the department. So as mentioned in the previous slides, gator bags and irrigates increase the time efficiency in watering. The young trees with gator bags saw a reduction of 38% in staff time, while the historic stone pines saw a 77% reduction in time. In addition to time savings, gator bags help with the development during drought conditions. Water constantly percolates into the soil until the bag needs to be refilled. And irrigates have the same effect. They work to maintain the health of the mature stone pines. The photo on the right shows the irrigation system laid out. Water works to percolate down through the soil, and this proves to be more effective than hand watering the tree as the tree gets more water. The containers on the left provide 125 gallons of water, ensuring that the trees only need to be watered every 1 to 2 weeks. So this graph compares the total number of waterings and the individual trees being watered. An example of this is in July. There are 644 waterings, but 519 trees that were watered. So this basically says that some of these trees were watered more than once. And the trees that were watered more than once were most likely Italian stone pines or young trees, as these are the trees we were trying to save during the drought conditions. So this data, aside from what's shown, it can help us track the frequency of trees being watered to ensure they're surviving throughout the drought, as well as establish a standard amount of trees watered per month. Currently, we're at about 30 trees watered a month, and the standard time could help us plan for the watering in the future.
Sorry, it's about 30 trees a day.
Oh, yeah, sorry, 30 trees a day.
About 580 a month is our current capacity given our resources today. Okay, so again, what does all this data do for us? Well, as we mentioned in the beginning, it starts to build confidence in our capacity, creates standard times, and then from there we can use this information to help project work out. It informs our annual maintenance plans and reporting. We can use these standard times to illustrate the cost to do work. It's a comparison tool. We can compare our standard times against costs and contract bids, and it helps support our drought planning. As Sam mentioned, as the data was coming in and we were realizing how long it took to water stone pines and trees, we knew we needed to do something, and those results led to an action, you know, implementing the irrigates and stone pines, irrigates and gator bags. And so we'll continue to use this data to help us monitor tree conditions and expand our watering efforts, and of course prioritize what trees get watered and at what frequency. And so for our next steps, we've been working out the kinks on paper, hoping that the next step would be electronic data tools, putting the tools in the hands of our forestry crew who are completely capable of entering this data, will help minimize not only paper, but staff time spent entering data and hopefully data entry errors.
We did receive additional water trucks, so we'll be looking to reprioritize how we're going to water and who's going to water with that new resource. And then given that we can water, you know, 30 trees a day, how can we expand this? And we think route planning might be one of those options. We currently have ArcGIS as a tool in-house, no extra cost, that we could start to use. So we'll be looking into those resources as well. And that concludes our presentation. And I'd be happy to take any comments or questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all of you for this. Does anyone have comments or questions? Yes, Ms. French.
First, I want to thank you very much for taking the time to really get in and understand what it takes to maintain our forest, especially at this time of drought. It's super important, and we got to keep going until we get rain from heaven, right? So thank you for that, and it really does help. And I think for me, I see it here in the report, but I don't recall you mentioning it out loud. The number of staff for watering is 1.5. Is that correct?
Madam Chair, Commissioner French, it's an average. You know, there is one full-time staff designated to watering. At times, we have two, if not one. So this is an average.
It's an average. Yeah. Okay, great. And the staff time for maintenance, the FTEs or whatever it's called.
Madam Chair, Commissioner French, I'm sorry. I'm not understanding the question.
The number of staff for the maintenance aspect. So it's one
number of staff. Yes, okay. Madam Chair, Commissioner French, we have five staff designated to maintenance.
Plus contract.
You're right. I'm sorry. That number is six.
Great.
Anything else? Any other comments? Yeah, Mr. Rincon, did you?
Those watering bags. You know, they're great, but they're not the prettiest things. That's my only comment.
Ms. Longstreet.
I think it's interesting also to look at the emergencies and understanding, you know, what a storm can do and how that throws off and, you know, how important it is to have our staff available for those incidents. You know, that it's very interesting that how that goes up in time, you know.
Chair Wiscombe and Commissioners, I want to expand on that point. With six field staff, one dedicated strictly to watering for the bulk of his time, when we get somebody to call in that a branch broke on a tree, wherever that is in the city, my five remaining staff have to pull off of what they're doing, drive across town to take care of that emergency. All of that impacts their productivity to produce the number of trees. So I think that that's really an important aspect to point out. It's not just the fact that a storm came through and they have to deal with the storm, but it really impacts their regular work on a day-to-day basis when we get a branch and they have to pull off of what they're doing.
I also think it's important that we have them, because I think that's when you can't get that contract labor to come out right then and do what our staff does. And so I do appreciate the work that they do in that way to keep our streets and sidewalks safe. So they're very valued. My ex used to be a tree trimmer for the city.
Ms. French?
And just one last thing. I just want to confirm you are planning to continue to collect this data going forward, and I think it'll help fine-tune some of those places where maybe the data's been skewed because it's only a short period of time you've been collecting this extra data.
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioner French, exactly. We do plan to continue this. This was kind of our trial period. We've worked out many kinks along the way. We think the information is valuable. Is this Commission has seen when you have this type of data, you're often poised to advocate for resources, justify resource needs, and we think this will help us get there as well.
Yes, go ahead.
Just one quick comment. I heard back about maybe a couple weeks ago on NPR, National Public Radio, about the city of Melbourne, Australia, and how they presented similar information. They rolled it out on a web basis, so basically neighborhoods can participate in the upkeep of trees, basically by reporting and whatnot. But also, I guess a lot of people are starting to write to their trees saying, "Dear tree, you know, I love you," and blah blah blah. But I thought it was a great story. So if you haven't heard that one, you know, tune it in, and maybe we could do something similar here.
Thank you very much for all your comments. This is really impressive. I've heard council members say on many occasions that they're very concerned with about our trees in this drought, and I've heard it many times from them. So I hope you're going to present this to them at some point in time and show them what you've done so far and what you plan to carry on with in the future.
Chair Wiscombe, absolutely. We are wrapping up our year-end report. We'll be presenting that to staff this week and next week. And absolutely, if we think it's valuable information, we should definitely be presenting it to them as well.
Yes, I think that would be really wise. The staff time reduction in watering is impressive with the installation of the gator bags and the irrigates, even though I have to agree with Mr. Rincon, they're not exactly aesthetically. Maybe we could install art on them or something. Now there's a novel concept. And I also think this is going to greatly help in advocating for funding for implementation of portions of our urban forest management plan. I think that's absolutely key, and this will be a really key piece as we push that forward. So thank you very much for this, and you did an excellent job, Mr. Fragoso, is that right?
Yeah.
Fragoso, yes. You did an excellent job on your presentation, and Ms. Burgess on yours, and Mr. Downey, thank you so much. Okay, we're going to move on to agenda item number 5, which is stormwater management program report.
I'm going to do just a bit of lead-in before we turn the program over to Jim Rumley. I wanted the commission to know that this has been an item that we've been looking to bring to you. You'll have a better understanding of why and the complexity of this program when you hear Mr. Rumley's presentation. But a good portion of the work that he does with this program affects all of the community, other city departments, working with staff. It's something that is a big focus for us. Over the years, issues come up and we work through them. For some staff in the city, this is something that they're working with on a routine basis. And yet, I'm not sure that we've ever brought this program before you to talk about what it is and what our role is with it via the Creeks program. So I'm really, we've been looking for an agenda that had room. This is it, and I'm very pleased that Mr. Rumley is here to present to you about the stormwater management program for the city.
Thank you, Ms. Rapp, commissioners. I'm Jim Rumley. I'm a water resources specialist with the Creeks Division, and part of my job is to administer the city's stormwater management program. I also focus most of my work time on post-construction requirements, which we'll talk. I'll tell you exactly what that means, and we'll get into that in a minute. So really, you can think of the city's stormwater management program as a group of activities intended to reduce pollutants discharged to the creeks and ocean through the city's storm drain system. And I'm going to talk about 5 primary components of the program. We'll talk about construction runoff, illicit discharge detection and elimination, outreach, post-construction, and water quality monitoring. But first, let's give you a little bit of background about where our program got its roots and why we do what we do. It really originated with the Federal Clean Water Act, and the federal government then delegated its authority to the state water board and the regional water board. The water board issued municipalities such as Santa Barbara a stormwater discharge permit which we've had since 2006. And the permit is, you can think of that as just a group of rules that we have to comply with so the city can discharge stormwater through its storm drain system. And again, it's all designed to reduce pollutants going into our creeks and ocean. Creeks Division does provide the overall coordination for our program, and but all city staff are responsible for making sure that pollutants are not discharged to the storm drain system through their work activities. So the first component of our program that we'll talk about is construction runoff control. And our Building and Safety Division is primarily responsible for satisfying the requirements of this component. All construction projects that are proposing any soil disturbance have to have an erosion and sediment control plan. These plans indicate where sediment and erosion control measures will be installed just to prevent sediment during storms from flowing off the site into the storm drains. One of the new permit requirements for this component of our program is to keep an inventory of all the current projects that have these sediment and erosion control plans and to keep a record of all the inspections that happen. And basically, this is in case the city gets audited. The water board comes to town, and they want to know exactly which projects have these plans and what the city's done to make sure that they've installed the right measures to prevent sediment from flowing off the site during storms. Last fiscal year, Building and Safety reviewed 43 of these plans. And just here's an example. It's kind of difficult to read. There's a lot going on here. But here's an example of what an erosion and sediment control plan looks like. You can see that there's a concrete washout basin indicated at the top there. Up here. We've got some gravel bags that will channel water towards some of the erosion control measures, such as this sediment basin. This plan also indicates that straw rolls and erosion control blankets will be installed on the hillside to prevent that sediment from flowing off. Also, there's a construction entrance here at the top that's indicated. And commonly, I don't see it on this plan, but you'll see some sort of measure to make sure when the trucks drive in and out that sediment is taken off their wheels and that sort of thing. The next component of our program is illicit discharge detection and elimination. And this is something that I dealt with for 5 years with the Creeks Division. I was a former code enforcement officer for Creeks. We have a new code enforcement officer, and his primary job is to respond to enforcement calls and illicit discharge reports. And the goal of this component of our program is to identify and eliminate sources of water pollution. And so, you know, it's also our goal when we receive reports of water pollution that we get out there right away. And for the last several years, we've been able to respond to every call that we've received on the same day that we get that report. We have a hotline that is our code enforcement officer's main line, and that's 897-2688. If you call that line during business hours, you're likely to get a live human that is ready to run out and respond to anything that you see. And I encourage you, if you ever see something in the street that doesn't look right, some dirty water in the street, or somebody, a construction site where there's sediment in the street, or they're doing some type of washing that's generating something, some water that looks kind of funny and polluted to you, give us a call, and we'd love to go out and investigate. So some of the new permit requirements that this component of our program are working towards is to complete an inventory of commercial industrial facilities. This is a list that we're going to send up to the regional board, and these are facilities that need an industrial discharge permit with the water board that don't have one. So we're going to look at city business licenses and compare those with the businesses that currently have industrial permits, and those that we find that need one, we'll send a list to the water board, and they'll ask these businesses to get a permit. We've also been asked to map some storm drain outfalls.
A question, what kind of a business, just an example of a type of business that would need a
any type of business where pollutants could flow off? Would an industrial type of business, for example, metal recycling would be one such example.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. We're also going to be completing a map of all storm drain outfalls. And that's kind of a weird term. If you don't know what an outfall is, it's essentially the end of the storm drain pipe. It's where the water from our storm drain system flows into our creeks. We're going to be training all field staff. We've been training all field staff, but we'll continue to train all field staff. And the reason for this is we want to make sure that all city employees who are in the field that have the potential to contribute to water pollution through their work activities, we want to make sure that they know they have an alternative, and they know how to prevent water pollution through their work tasks. Also, to let them know what an illicit discharge is, so if they see something, they can report it. We're going to come up with an enforcement response plan as well. Our enforcement program has been in place for many years, but we need to formalize it into a document. So we've got it all in one place on what we do when we respond to an enforcement call. I've got a couple photos here to give you an example of what we see on some calls. And admittedly, these are kind of extreme examples, but nonetheless, this is what we see sometimes. This first one is an illicit discharge from a restaurant. All of the water you see here is in Mission Creek, but none of that water is actually creek water. That's all wash water mixed with grease. And so, you know, restaurants have grease. Occasionally there's spills. And in this particular case, the restaurant washed off that grease into the street, which flowed to the storm drain system, which flowed to the creek. For this particular incident, we were able to get this all cleaned up. We have a contractor that can respond very quickly to these sorts of spills, and they were able to vacuum this up and got it removed from the creek. Here's another example. What you're seeing this gentleman doing is saw cutting, and he's cutting the concrete, and that's water that's being used to lubricate the blade. And if it's not captured, it has the potential to flow off into the street. So what happens when we find a situation like this is we immediately stop the work, and we instruct the contractors to clean this up. And we offer them education about the right way to do this work. And essentially, they need to make sure none of this discharge leaves their property. None of it goes into the street. And so this was quite a mess. And so sometimes it can be very difficult to clean up immediately, but we ask them to get on it and try to do their best work to get it cleaned up. And we follow up with a warning letter, which often has a deadline to get it cleaned up. And most of the time, it gets cleaned up before we issue fines, but we do occasionally issue fines if the spill doesn't get cleaned up appropriately. Another job responsibility of our code enforcement officer is to clean up illegal dumping and to look for illegal dumping. Every week we send several sites to our contractor for cleanup. It's not often that we find who's responsible for these types of dumping incidents, but we can always get it cleaned up. Last year, our contractor removed over 100,000 pounds of trash from our creeks and beaches. We also see lots of encampments in the creeks. And just like the illegal dumping incidences, we can always get these cleaned up. However, one significant difference from an illegal dumping and encampment is that we provide a 48-hour cleanup notice to occupants of encampments. We don't just come in and take items that we find in the creek when they belong to someone. We give the occupants 48 hours to get what they need before we come in and clean it up. The next component is our outreach. We have a full-time outreach coordinator, and her goal is to implement education and outreach related to improving creek and ocean water quality. This involves creating media campaigns. You might have seen some of the commercials that we have. The Ocean Begins on Your Street is one of the commercials our outreach coordinator put together. Our outreach coordinator also oversees presentations to school children. Each year we offer education to 3,000 students, and this includes watershed education. The students have an opportunity to sample creek water for pollutants, and they also conduct a beach cleanup where they're able to count and sort the types of trash that they find. Our outreach coordinator also coordinates volunteer opportunities such as beach cleanups and storm drain marking events. One of the new permit requirements for our outreach component is a community-based social marketing. And you might have seen some of the signs around town. Close the poop loop is the slogan that we've chosen to go with. Here's an example of the poster that we've got at Arroyo Borough Beach. And community-based social marketing is just a partnership between Santa Barbara County cities. And the goal is to achieve a measurable behavioral change. And what we chose to focus on is to try to persuade dog owners to clean up after their pets more frequently. Each community was allowed to choose one location where they wanted to focus the outreach, and we chose the off-leash dog area at Arroyo Borough Beach. And at the end of the program, the consultant will submit a report to let us know how successful the program was. Post-construction is the next component we'll talk about. This is, again, what I deal with for most of my hours at the city. And that's another kind of a funny term. It's pretty jargony. But really what it means is after a construction project is finished, it's the ongoing treatment of stormwater before it leaves the site. So when we get rain, the water that falls on all hardscape will flow into some type of treatment method, and pollutants will be removed before it flows off the site. Some of examples of treatment methods include permeable pavers, bioswales, bioretention systems, and infiltration basins. And we'll talk more about some of these in a minute. But you all probably are familiar with some of the permeable pavers that have been installed at the parks, Stevens Park, Oak Park, Alice Keck Park Memorial Gardens will be getting them. Veracruz will be getting them. One of the requirements from our permit recently was that the regional board wanted our post-construction requirements to be mandatory. So we have a new municipal code ordinance that makes these requirements mandatory for certain construction projects of over a certain size. And the threshold is dependent on the land use, and it ranges from 500 square feet of new impervious area to 4,000 square feet of new or replaced impervious area. A couple of the projects that you might be familiar with that are going to be complying with post-construction are La Entrada and the Cabrillo Pavilion bathhouse renovation. Here's a photo of some permeable pavers. And as opposed to asphalt and concrete, where the stormwater just flows off, with permeable pavers, you can kind of make out some gaps in between the pavers here where stormwater will flow into instead of sheet flowing off. And below these pavers, there's layers of gravel. And the idea is that the stormwater will flow down slowly through these layers of gravel, and pollutants will be removed. And in many installations, below the gravel is just native soil, and the water will infiltrate into the ground. This is an example of a bioswale. And with bioswales, these are flow-through treatment methods as opposed to infiltration. Although some infiltration will happen with the soil, the idea is to remove pollutants as the water flows through the swale and is taken out by the plants. Here's a bioretention planter. In the back, you can see downspouts. Those are coming from the roof. And most of the time, for many houses and businesses, roof water will flow into the downspouts and then into a storm drain. These downspouts will flow directly into this bioretention planter. And what a bioretention planter is, it's just a planter, but it has very specific soil type. It has a sandy soil type that's really good at removing pollutants. Below that sand, there's usually about 2 feet of soil, and below that is a gravel layer generally. And some of these bioretention planters will have an underdrain if infiltration is not recommended on the site. And an underdrain is essentially a slotted pipe with holes in it where the water can flow into and out from the planter. The last component of our program that we'll talk about is water quality monitoring. The objective of our water quality monitoring component is to obtain information through water sampling to develop strategies for water quality improvement and to communicate effectively with the public about water quality. Each year, our water quality research coordinator prepares a research and monitoring plan. And this plan talks about what the ideas that we want answers to and the sampling that's going to hopefully answer these questions and ideas. And so this year we have three new components on our research and monitoring plan, and these are permit requirements. One is the dry weather sampling of the outfalls that we talked about earlier. So really, in dry weather, there shouldn't be any water coming out of these outfalls. If it's not raining, they should be dry. And for any that are flowing, we'll want to sample and to see if there are any pollutants included in this water that's flowing out of these outfalls. If we find pollutants over a certain threshold, we can start an enforcement case and try to figure out where that water's coming from, who's responsible, and how we can get it to stop. We're also going to be doing increased monitoring of impaired water bodies. And impaired water bodies are really our creeks that the regional board has determined have too high of a pollutant load. And so we're going to be doing some bacteria sampling and toxicity sampling. And our hope is that we'll find that pollutant levels have reduced or been reduced, and we can get them delisted. And so they won't be impaired anymore. That's our hope. We'll see how that goes. We're also going to be doing a special study, and this is another term that the regional board uses. We had a choice here. We could have done some sampling that the regional board thought that all communities would benefit from, or we could choose a special study what we thought was very specific to our community that would benefit our program more. And so what we chose to do for our special study is to focus water sampling on places where we were going to install permeable pavers. And so before we installed the permeable pavers, we did some water sampling to find out the pollutant loads that will be reduced by those permeable pavers. So instead of those pollutants flowing off into the storm drain system, they're going to now, or once this project is completed, they'll flow into the permeable pavers, and we'll have a record of the pollutants that we're reducing and removing from the system. So in addition to our five components and the work that goes into those, we have program reporting requirements. Every year we have to submit an online annual report to the regional board, and that's through the state webpage. The Creeks Division is responsible for compiling the annual report. Our most recent annual report was submitted electronically in October of 2014. What we're going to be working on next is the year three requirements, where we have a five-year permit. The permit was first issued in February of 2013. And we're currently in year three. Year two ended on June 30th. And in October 15th, our year two annual report is due, where we'll let the regional board know that we met all of the requirements for year two. So that should give you a probably more detailed overview than you wanted, but hopefully you'll have a better understanding of our stormwater management program. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer those for you.
Thank you, Mr. Rumbley. That was just a great report. Does anyone have questions or comments here? Anyone? Mr. Rincon?
Hi, I was wondering, are you going to be engaging in like a total streets program where we actually start taking some of the flow from streets and putting them into bioswales, similar to what's been done in other major cities where they just kind of remove parking spots and create bioswales there just to treat a street runoff?
Chair Wiskum, Commissioner Rincon Ybarra, no projects like that are scheduled, but it is something we've talked about internally, and it's something we're interested in. We would want to work with Public Works to see how feasible that is. And I know we've talked about it. We're starting with sidewalks at Alice Keck Park Memorial Garden. We're going to be doing some work in the public right-of-way. At Veracruz Park, we're going to be doing a public alley. But as far as a public street, we'll be doing that as well. We're going to be installing permeable pavers at Quarantina, where some of the stone pines are. There's going to be a two-block stretch where we're going to have the whole streets are permeable pavers. But as far as installing bioswales on a public street, we haven't gotten there yet. But you know, it's I imagine in the future it's something we'll look at.
Yeah, a lot of cities throughout California are starting to implement that kind of program. So it doesn't put all the whole burden on Parks and Rec. It actually gets, you know, Public Works involved, too.
Okay, anyone else? Ms. French.
Great presentation, and I'm pretty familiar with this work. It's fantastic, and you guys are, I've called the hotline a couple of times myself, and you're fantastic, and I understand you really go out and really help educate people. A lot of times they're just unaware where the water, the wastewater is going, and you guys are, have been awesome about that, so I wanted to acknowledge that. The second thing is just left my brain. Sorry, I'm enthusiastic.
Welcome to the club. Yeah, it's happened to me about three times today.
Sorry about that.
Quick question.
Yes, Mr.
Mr. Rumbly, is it possible to get some of those close-the-loop, poop-loop signs so I can start posting some in my neighborhood also? Because I see, you know, I'm probably one of the few pet owners that actually picks up.
Chair Wiscombe, Commissioner Reen County Barra. Potentially, let me talk to our outreach coordinator. See if she has any extras. I know we have some around, but I'm not sure if we have any more. But
right, it would be nice just to kind of push some out into the community, just keep people thinking about, you know, their responsibility as a pet owner.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you.
There's a possibility, I would assume, after on that same subject, after the report comes back on the test run at Arroyo Borough using these signs, that they might push them out into more of the community if it's successful.
Chair Wiscombe, absolutely. Yeah, that's the purpose of the report, to see if the program is successful. The intention is to expand the program. Yeah, and I didn't mention it before, but the one of the ways that they're working on determining if it's successful or not is to count instances of pet owners leaving things their pet leaves behind before the program and after.
Gee, can I have that job? That
my favorite is the people that bag it and leave it.
Yeah, bag it and leave it. Yeah. I was interested in the water sampling where you're installing the permeable pavers. I think that's pretty fascinating. I'm familiar with how permeable pavers are installed. Is part of the goal in that is when you determine what the water quality is, you may alter the base material to, for instance, pick up more of the pollutants. I mean, you can't alter, they have to be constructed a certain way, but that you may perhaps deepen the cutout for the basin for the pavers. I'm losing track of my words from my professional career here, you know. So is that part of the goal, that you might have an opportunity based on water quality to alter the base material to respond to the pollutants in the water?
Yeah, Chair Wiscombe, absolutely. The types of base that's under those pavers.
Base, yeah.
We've got a good system as far as, you know, it's a certain type of small aggregate just below the paver, and the aggregate gets bigger as you go down. And you can absolutely increase the depth, excavate deeper, and increase the capacity. So the Water Board is really interested in load reduction of pollutants right now. And so for our special study, we focused on that because we thought that not only would it be very good for the community to know that, hey, this is the amount of pollutants that we've reduced from the system, but the Regional Board is also very interested in that. And so that's primarily why we chose that project. But we can absolutely increase the depth of permeable pavers. It's a matter of cost. You know, the deeper you go,
right. Yeah.
The more expensive it's going to cost.
And more excavation material you have to do, and yeah, the whole nine yards. But yeah, I think that's a really interesting study. I'd be certainly interested in seeing more on that in the future when you've gotten further into it. It's great. Well, this was an incredible report. I think it's really fascinating, and Did you have something to add, Ms.
Madam Chair and Commission, I just want to reemphasize a couple of things because oftentimes we're the messenger. The Creeks program is the messenger to people who don't want to hear whatever the stormwater requirements are. So I really want to emphasize again, this is a federally mandated program. The city has a stormwater permit. This is a city program. It's in the municipal code. And the Creeks program and all, there's different city staff elements that are involved with the implementation of this. And as Mr. Rumbly mentioned, we're really trying to educate all of our field staff, so they are knowledgeable as well. But I think that it's really important because sometimes people just focus on, oh, it's the Creeks program, you know, like, oh, you know, they're going to make us do something environmentally right and it's just too expensive. This is a city program and it's good for the community. And so sometimes that gets lost. And I just thought it would be good to reemphasize that. As you listen to this, because it's really a very significant program. I think especially as all of us have responded to the drought, and then in those rare instances where we've just seen these downpours of water, and we're all wishing we could just capture it all, rather than having it run out to the ocean. And so I think there will be more and more conversation about exactly how do we do that. So thank you for the report. It was very good.
Yeah, it was just great. Hotline number again, please.
Chair Wiskam, 897-2688.
897-2688. Okay. For any of those that are listening at home, yes. Okay, Ms. French.
From my time on the Creeks Committee, I do know that there's a really great partnership with UCSB, one of the labs at UCSB, in looking at pollutant runoffs and helping with some of the testing and looking at the effectiveness of bioswales. And so there's a really great scientific coordination between the university and the Creeks Committee in, you know, educating the process of how we can clean up those pollutants.
Great.
In the process.
Yeah. That's great. Very thorough program. It's really great. Thank you, Mr. Rumbly. Appreciate it. Okay. Okay, the agenda item number 6 is the annual advisory committee reports. They're for information. If anyone has any comments on them or questions on them, but they're for our reading pleasure. Anyone have
no comments.
Okay. So we're moving on to agenda item number 7, which is annual election of chair and vice chair, which we do to serve for the period of August 1st, 2015 through July 30, 2016. Ms. Longstreet.
I feel like it would be a good thing for you to remain chair if you would. I would like to nominate you. Since we're going through transition at this point, and you've done a good job of representing our commission at hundreds of meetings that some of the rest of us wouldn't have the opportunity to go to, I really do appreciate your representation. So I would make a motion to reappoint you to be chair this year.
Okay.
No comments.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second that.
Is there any discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay.
Do you accept?
Yes. Absolutely, I do. Yes, sure.
Well, then I'm just going to continue on because...
Roll right into it.
And Mr. Rincon and Barra, I know you are somewhat new to our commission, but I feel like you would be a good vice chair.
Is that a motion?
That's a motion.
And I'll second that motion.
If he accepts the challenge.
I do.
You do. Okay. So any other discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, you can vote for yourself.
Okay, that's fine. So we have a new chair and a vice chair for the upcoming year, and with no further...
One comment I would make is I understand there's only four of us here tonight, but I just would like to acknowledge that our other three members are fairly new, and I think their time will come to join the ranks, but of chair and vice chair, but I just didn't want them to feel left out of this decision making.
Yeah, and I think when I finish my sixth year as chair, I think it will be time to turn this gavel over, which I've never used, to someone else. I'm going to use it right now. Meeting adjourned.
And I think we should adjourn our meeting.